Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in the Philippines. Yeah, I just wanted to make a quick video. Confirmations, I saw other people, of course, are making confirmation videos. The Lord is speaking to lots of us in different ways. As it says in the beginning of the book of Hebrews, you know, He spoke to us in times past and sundry times, old times, by various ways, and now He's spoken to us by His Son, Jesus Christ. And so the Lord speaks to us, too, in various ways. And the spirit of prophecy is about Jesus Christ, the Word of God tells us in the New Testament. So, anyway, I had made a video a while back, maybe one of my first videos, and I'd mentioned a dream I'd had about, and I think the title of the video is The Rapture, Who Will Go? And the Lord had given me that the song, you know, to a dream, and then I had the song, you know, from the Christmas song, Oh Come Let Us Adore Him. Oh, come let us adore Him, Christ the Lord. You know, and about the wise men still seek Him and all that I said in that video. I recommend that you go watch it. And the Lord, I guess I could make it all in one video. Anyway, the Lord had given me a word. Someone, I was ministering to someone the other day. And the Lord was leading me to talk to them about His love. You know, that He loved them with a steadfast love. And this person is a backslider. It's a relative of my wife. And I was telling them, as the Lord was leading me, I was ministering to them as I do in the ministry. That's probably, you know, my favorite time from the Lord is not really speaking to a group, of course, unless revival breaks out, the power of God. But my favorite time is when I'm flowing in the Spirit and speaking to someone, and, you know, as the Lord would lead me, you know, into their problems, because the Lord would, you know, use me to speak directly to their situation. You know, like I've said in other videos, sometimes we see the symptom, like someone's a drunk, someone's depressed. You know, and in the natural, we look at those things. But what God does, God goes to the root, to uproot that problem in your life. So by the Spirit, when you're talking about word of wisdom, word of knowledge, you know, moving in the prophetic and those different ways. And I've done a video about the gifts of the Spirit. There's a difference between the word of wisdom and the word of knowledge. But the point is that God would, I could do whole teachings about that, but not so many people are interested in watching. You need to do deep study if you want to know these things, not just a shallow skim over the top. You know, if you want to flow in those things, you got to study it and know about it and get into it. If the Lord puts that desire in your heart, that means that probably He wants to use you in that area. If that's, you know, the desire of your heart is to, you know, to know about those things and get into it and study it, then, yeah, maybe it's in from the Lord that He wants to use you in that area, like a word of knowledge, word of wisdom, prophecy in the church. Anyway, those gifts from 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Nine different gifts listed there. And then in, I guess it's Galatians chapter 5, you have the fruit of the Spirit. That's a whole different thing. We need the fruit, you know, of love and all that. And then, of course, that goes in line with the gifts. Anyway, back to my point. The Lord gave me something I never heard anybody say. Probably somebody has, but it's along that line of, like, you know, come let us adore Him. Who's going in the rapture? Adoring the Lord. And then there's people that, you know, had messaged me, you don't have to adore the Lord. All you have to do is believe Jesus died on the cross. But Jesus was asked, what is the greatest commandment? You know, and He said to love the Lord with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and all your body, and love your neighbor as yourself. You know, all the other Ten Commandments and all of that leans on that. And Jesus, you know, that's the whole point of love. And, of course, even before we love our neighbor, loving God is number one. So that's when I did the video, as the Lord led me to make that one, come let us adore Him. You know, love is, you know, in English you're talking about love is not, it can be a state of being, but it's not an action. We're in, like, the King James, it used the word charity. Okay, because in Greek there's many words for love, and agape is the word for love that you're talking about. God so agape'd the world. He, sacrificial love, sacrificial giving love. That's why the word charity in the King James is actually a good word, because it's not just love, it's love in action. So when those people who are, who think that they can, you know, that they're, who think they're saved, let's put it this way, by just, oh, well, I believe Jesus died on the cross for my sins. But in James it says, don't you know, oh, vain man. You know, it says, even the devils believe in God and tremble. But don't you know, oh, vain man, faith without works is dead. Okay, so that's what we're talking about, the works of faith. It's not about going and building a bridge or whatever, you know, or something like that. You know, building a chair, a work. It's talking about loving the Lord with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and all your body, and all, you know, and loving your neighbor as yourself. But so the Lord said, you know, when I was ministering to this person, the Lord told me to tell this person what it means to be a Christian. How do you get to heaven? Like I made that video, you know, the rapture, who will go? Here's the answer from the Lord. I haven't heard anybody say this or preach this. and it came straight from the Spirit of the living God. He said, how do you get to heaven? The answer is, love the Lord with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and all your body. And then, of course, love your neighbor as yourself. That is how you get to heaven. That's how you enter the kingdom of heaven. It's a commandment from the Lord. Jesus gave his disciples one commandment at the Last Supper. You know, love each other as I have loved you. See, that's our commandment from the Lord. So, that's how you're going to go in the rapture. That's how you know you're going to heaven. If someone says, Jesus said, if you love me, you'll do what I say. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. We're talking about New Testament. Now, I'm not talking about, you know, sacrificing animals there at the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. Under the law and all those different laws, you know, in the Old Testament, under the covenant of Moses. We're talking about the love that God had from Adam and Eve, that he had with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the relationship he had with Noah, the relationship he had with Moses and those guys, and all through the Bible, Samuel, all those guys, King David, everybody. God loved King David because he was a man after his own heart. King David made mistakes, but he loved the Lord with all of his heart. That's why God honored him and said that his kingdom, would, you know, his throne would always someone would sit on his throne. That's why Jesus is called the Son of David, and that he would sit on the throne of King David. Because God honored King David because he loved him so much, even though he even had somebody killed so he could steal the guy's wife. Got her pregnant while the guy was in a war. One of his generals was in a war. He got his guy's wife pregnant, Bathsheba, the mother of King Solomon, and had the guy killed so he could get his wife. But God forgave him because he repented of it. Psalm 51 is the repentance words of King David. He went on with his life. So the bottom line is, it's not about what if you sin or not, see? Nobody's perfect. Nobody's going to be holy on their own. You know, you can't be holy. You can't be perfect. But the difference is, what I'm trying to say and what the Word of God is trying to say, the difference is, if you love the Lord, you desire to please Him. It's not just, well, you know, Jesus died for me, so I'm just going to do what I want. No, Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. So what I'm telling you is, lots of people can say, I believe in Jesus. They can, you know, confess with their mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, but it's not believed in their heart. You see what I mean? Because with the heart, you know, you're unto righteousness from the work of your heart. So if you're born again, it says old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. So don't let anybody tell you, you know, when you got saved, if you really got saved, it was by the Spirit of God. Jesus said, no man comes to me unless the Father draws them. So it's by the power of the Spirit of God, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is what's going to raise us up. The Holy Spirit is what draws us to Jesus. It's, when you get people, you know, these carnal-minded people, they'll say, oh, don't let it be, you know, about an experience. Let me tell you something. If you got saved, you had an, if you didn't have an experience with God, you didn't get saved. You got to have an experience with God, an encounter with the living God. And what does it mean to be saved? Before you can get saved, you have to know that you are lost and without hope in this world. You had to be a lost sheep, and God, by His Spirit and by His Word, through someone preaching to you or what, reading the Bible yourself or however it happened, God, by His Spirit, like in the book of James, He held a mirror up to your face, and you saw yourself for what you really are, a violator of the Ten Commandments, and a liar, a cheat, a thief, an adulterer at heart, as Jesus said, if you look on a man or a woman with lust in your heart. You've already committed adultery in your heart if you're married. You're lying. All of us, including myself, we've been liars. We've been thieves or whatever. If we took something that didn't belong to us, we've been a thief. You know, we've looked on people with lust. You know, we've committed adultery in our heart. All those things that we've done to violate God's holy perfection. That mirror is in our face from the Spirit of God, as Jesus said in John chapter 17, that the Holy Spirit would bring conviction of sin to the world. And we would see ourselves what we really are. And then we would say, we need you. Save me. You know, you would say, Jesus, save me. Deliver me from my own sin. Deliver me from my own evilness. Deliver me from my just punishment. That's what it means to become born again. It's to face, not just some, I don't really need to be saved, but, you know, hey. You know, I'll take it because I don't want to go to hell. No, we have to know that we're in violation of God's rules, and we have to know. That's what the Bible says about the Ten Commandments, the Old Testament, the Law of Moses. Lots of people want to keep trying to follow the Law of Moses. The Bible says that the law is a schoolmaster to bring us to the knowledge of sin and death. You know, if you drive down the road and there's no speed limit sign, and you're going 100 miles an hour, hey, you didn't do anything wrong. Because there's no sign. But then if someone puts up a sign, 65 miles an hour or 100 kilometers an hour for other countries, then hey, when you go past that, then hey, you broke the law. You violated the law. You know, there's a punishment for violating the law. You know, no matter what, suppose, as an example, let me make this quick. I always make my videos long. Suppose you killed somebody, and then, okay, you killed somebody, and then you didn't get caught. And so you feel bad about it, and you say, hey, you know what, I think I'm going to start an orphanage, because I feel so bad about killing somebody. You know, and then you do an orphanage for 20 years, and you just give everything you got. You serve and serve with this orphanage and all that. And then after 20 years, you get caught, and they take you to court. Now, is the judge going to let you go for murder because you've been have an orphanage for 20 years? Does the having an orphanage for 20 years erase? Does that remove and erase the fact that you're a murderer? No, it doesn't. You're still a murderer. So therefore, you will be punished for being a murderer, no matter what. Now, he may lessen your sentence a little bit in that case in the natural world because, oh, you've done a lot of good things in that way in the human court. But you're still a murderer. But the thing about becoming, in the New Testament, under the blood of Jesus Christ, like in Isaiah chapter 1, it says, "Let's come now, let us reason together, though your sins be as scarlet, they will become white as snow." God says, "I will cast your sins away from me to the bottom of the sea of forgetfulness. As far as the east is from the west, so your sins shall be from you." When you repent, call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, you're forgiven. 1 John 1:9, for us Christians, when we backslide, when we sin, when we stumble in our daily walk with the Lord, it says, if we confess our sins, we, the church, it's written, that letter's written to the church, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Brothers and sisters, I'm getting ready to make another video of the revelations the Lord gave me about the soon coming rapture, soon coming tribulation. As other people are making videos of confirmation, let me tell you something. Ask yourself, do I love the Lord with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind, and all my body? And then second class, then the next level, do I love my neighbor as myself? Before you get into loving your neighbor as yourself, of course, first thing, get yourself 100% in love with the Lord. And then the rest is going to fall into place. It's just that simple. It's that simple. The love of many has waxed cold. Jesus said, To the last church, the Laodicean church, he says, I wish you were hot or cold. Because you're lukewarm, I'll spew you out of my mouth. Now, lots of people believe that, you know, those letters to the churches in Revelation chapter 2 and 3 are progressive in time, and that the Laodicean church is the end times church. You know, really, in the city of Laodicea, just to throw in a little bit of knowledge here from the earthly side, when that was written, in the city of Laodicea, they had their water brought in an aqueduct. You know, the Romans built aqueducts all over the place in the Roman Empire. And it was a hot spring where it was coming from. And then by the time it got to Laodicea, the water was lukewarm. And that's a good reference and the reason why Jesus said that. Because the actual water in Laodicea was lukewarm. So it made sense to them also. You know, it doesn't taste good. It's not hot like hot coffee or hot tea. Or cold like a soda or cold water or what, but lukewarm. Nobody wants to drink anything that's lukewarm. So don't be lukewarm. And don't, look, if you have any doubts in your mind about your relationship with the Lord, Romans chapter 8 says, his spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. If you have any doubt, any concern, don't listen to all these doctrines and stuff. Because being saved is not about babbling doctrines, okay? And babbling, and oh, I know this, I know that. No, it's a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Jesus is the one who saves you. And by his Spirit, he's the one to talk to you, to seal you as saved. He's the one to forgive you. It's not about it's about a person, the person of Jesus Christ. You need to get a hold of Jesus right now and until you have 100% peace in your heart and mind that you are going to be saved, that you're going to heaven, that you are going in the rapture. And you're going to heaven. If you have any doubt on any of those topics, just send me a message. I'm going to pray for you. I'll pray with you, whatever we need to do, that the Holy Spirit will bear witness with your spirit that you are a child of God. If you have any doubt, feel free to message me at any time, because you need to know. You know, there's no need to be any doubt if it's just in your mind or if you've really received the Lord in your spirit or whatever. You need to be born again, and you should be a new creature in Christ. And yes, of course, we still sin, but people can tell when you become a Christian, you're changed. You have a new, you know, brightness about your countenance. You know, you have a joy. You know, the fruit of the Spirit begin to bear in your heart. You want to tell people about Jesus and all that. You're a changed person. Then we go through where we start, you know, we get lukewarm if we don't maintain that. And that's what my channel is all about. is maintaining. You know, that's the spirit the Lord gave me. The prophetic anointing is about reviving the people. Going and knocking everything off the foundation that's not of God, that's been built. I've said this in other videos. Every church I go to and every person I minister to, usually the Lord uses me with Christians. Maybe they backslid or whatever. They've gotten off track. God sends me to tear down, just like Jeremiah, tear down and knock down everything that's not from the Lord, that's built on the foundation of Jesus Christ. Knock it down, and let's start building again, and give instructions on how to rebuild yourself as the temple of God, or the church that I go to as the temple of God. How to rebuild God's way, not man's way, but God's way. Amen, brothers and sisters.